Our presenter is Dr. John Kissel. Dr. Kissel is a civil and environmental engineer in the field of environmental and occupational health sciences. He is professor emeritus at the University of Washington, and his research includes human exposure assessment, dermal exposure and absorption, risk assessment, hazardous waste management, soil cleanup, and water quality. His current research activity includes investigation mitigation of firefighter exposure to carcinogenic PAHs. Please join me in welcoming Dr. John Kissel.
Thank you. Can you see my slides?
We can see your slides and hear you very clearly.
Great. The live streaming didn't really work for me, so I didn't hear the prior talk. So I don't know whether I'm fitting in well or not, but I'll go ahead anyway. There have been some recent experiments in which people attempted to decon firefighters after activities. The fentanyl work is very well known. We actually did a small project for the state of Washington, which got results somewhat similar to the fentanyl study, in that we found removal of surface loads without having tested for biomarkers. So we could report that that washing was at least somewhat efficacious. Recently, here et al. Have published a paper which got more mixed results, where washing was perhaps not very effective. So the Cure It All work questions the benefit of post-fire decon by washing, with the pertinent arguments having to do with no effect on hydroxypyrene urinary levels in first 18 hours, a claim of rapid dermal uptake of PAHs, which might clear the skin before washing would take effect, also raises the possibility of the so-called wash-in effect, which would ostensibly drive material on the skin into the skin, which would make washing counterproductive. And so I would like to talk about all three of those arguments. First, this is a generic slide. It's actually chlorpyrifos, not PAHs, but it's an observation that the pharmacokinetic response of the human body to agents delivered through the skin is different than the pharmacokinetic response of agents delivered, in this case, by ingestion, but also the inhalation response would look a lot more like the ingestion response than it does look like the dermal response. And the notion is that the dermal response is slowed quite a bit and peaks well after the, a PAHs would not necessarily act exactly like this, but the notion, this is days on this scale. So the peak metabolite appearance in urine from chlorpyrifos exposure occurs at 2 days rather than at the first hour or two, which is the case for the ingestion exposure. And so that's a general observation that the skin is a membrane, takes time to transport things through the skin, and the responses that we expect then are delayed as a consequence. All right, so 1-hydroxypyrene is a metabolite of pyrene, which is an indicator of smoke exposure, but pyrene is not a CPAH, a carcinogenic PAH. And so 1-hydroxypyrene is not a direct indicator of carcinogenic PAH exposure. It may be correlated because everything is in the smoke soup, but it's not a direct indicator. Carcinogenic PAHs are point of entry skin carcinogens. They don't have to be systematically absorbed for deleterious effect. The high molecular weight pHs, which is the carcinogenic ones, tend to be excreted in feces rather than urine. So the relevance of metabolites of non-carcinogenic pHs or of urinary mutagenicity to skin carcinogenicity is not at all clear. That's a research question, which, so far as I know, is not determined. The pH exposures that Keir showed were considerably less than the FENT loads. Now there's some issues there with skin sample pooling, which can dilute the load. Subject selection, so FENT and we in the University of Washington study ultimately found that our best results were in the most exposed individuals, in which it's statistically just easiest to show an effect if you start at high loads and if you start at low loads. And the Keir skin loads are actually pretty low, which raises the question about the actual intensity of the activity. They were half hour to 1 hour of a training exercise, and that may or may not be reflective of more intense exposures that might be occurred under other circumstances. Skin is a point of entry for the 1-hydroxypyrene precursor, so you would expect to see an effect. This is a this is work by Van Rouge et al. From quite a few years ago, where they monitored a creosote worker, and the open circles are the exposure without the intervention, and the dark circles are the exposure with the intervention. This is the hydroxypyrene excretion rate. And there's a clear effect there that the intervention, in this case, the intervention was to put the pyrene or the creosote worker in a Tyvek suit under their regular coveralls. And so that provides partial barrier to dermal exposure. This is without coveralls and with coveralls, and jaw and neck is the same because the Tyvek suit doesn't cover jaw or neck. Shoulder, upper arm, groin, so interior surfaces, there was substantial reduction in the pyrene load on skin by patch test after the activity, and in wrist, ankle, jaw, neck, there was no change. So there was still dermal exposure, but there was less dermal exposure. And that's reflected in a substantial reduction then in the hydroxypyrene signal. So you would expect if people are sufficiently exposed, then you would see a signal. And this is a creosote worker who worked an 8-hour shift rather than did a 30 to 60 minute training exercise. These loads, 10 nanograms per square centimeter, are much higher than the Keir et al. Results. So one of the issues with the Keir study is that the loads are actually pretty damn low. Okay, so second issue is the rate of pH absorption. And the Keir et al. Study cites some work by Silva, which is in turn taken from Sartorelli work, which is pH flux, a variety of pH compounds from acetone deposition. Acetone deposition leaves pure compound on the skin. So it's the maximum, essentially after acetone deposition, you have the maximum fugacity or thermodynamic activity of the compound on the skin, And if you've also provided an infinite dose, then that would ultimately lead to a maximum steady state flux. So that's a worst case flux, not a normal flux. And in the papers where Sartorelli reported flux from acetone deposition, they also reported flux from lubricating oil from coal dust. And in both of those latter cases, the observed flux was actually below detection limit, and so negligible. So there's a dramatic difference between acetone deposition results and flux from matrices. Peckham et al. Did soil work, only BAP, not other PAHs. In that case, they found fluxes from acetone deposition 10 to 100 times greater than the flux from soil. So if you have a matrix of some kind that is not saturated, you expect lower rates of uptake, and the Silva reported uptake fluxes are really not likely to occur from smoke deposition, and so are overstatements of likely flux. And here's a research question, which I don't think anybody knows the answer to, but maybe I'm wrong about this. What is the thermodynamic activity of PAHs in fire, smoke, or soot? I'm retired. I don't have a lab anymore. I can't answer this question myself, but I would recommend that some people who are interested in exposure of firefighters might want to address this question. Some headspace analysis of soot could answer that question, at least for the low molecular weight PAHs, and would be a significant research contribution if somebody wants to take it on. And then the last effect that we need to talk about is the so-called wash-in effect. It's been heavily promoted by Moody and Maybach and their colleagues. They've been aggressively publishing review papers which state that the wash-in effect is effectively well known and well established. The original origins derived from in vitro experiments conducted by Moody and a couple of co-workers at Health Canada. And the arguments are presented in the older work and in the newer work involve a lot of special pleading, which I don't find convincing at all. Moody did a whole series of experiments with different compounds. This is he didn't always present the results in a way that was quantitatively accessible. So this is extracted from graphical results, but this is a diffusion experiment done with 2,4-D amine. What we have here is an initial rapid increase, which is what you expect. You load skin in an in vitro diffusion cell, and you monitor the receptor fluid. And you see an initial spike. And then what you expect, if you've provided an infinite dose, this will go up rapidly and then tail off and reach some steady state level. But that's not what occurred here. There was a rapid uptake and then an extremely rapid decline in uptake. And then subsequently, they did a washing step, and washing in vitro is always kind of a poor substitute for washing in vivo because you can't really do in vitro the sorts of washing steps that you would do if you were dealing with a human being that you could stick in a shower, for instance. But in any case, they got this spike at 24 hours after they did their ostensible washing. And this is the claimed wash-in effect. So nothing's going on for a long time, and then we get this spike. And this is the claim that washing is actually dangerous and leads to bigger doses. So let's look at a diffusion cell for those of you who are not familiar with these sorts of things. So you have a donor side, which is where you put the dose of what this says drug, because this particular outfit does drug testing, but that can be a drug or an environmental chemical or whatever it is that you're dosing. And it sits on top of a membrane. In this case, the membrane is human cadaver skin, or it could be something else. But for in vitro work, human cadaver skin is the best option. And then there's a receptor media, and this is a flow through system. So this is being mixed, and it's continuous sampling. Older systems might have been static systems, in which case you had to manually sample and replace, which is more primitive, but a lot of the older results are reported that way. Typically, this receptor cell is jacketed with another liquid, an external liquid cell to control the temperature, because you want to run this at physiological temperature. But a really key thing here is contact between the membrane and the receptor fluid. And one of the big problems in vitro experimentation is you can get, especially in these systems that work top down like this, you can get air bubbles at this receptor surface. And if you get an air bubble, that will block uptake. And lo and behold, that's what we're looking at here. This is a flashing neon sign that says air bubble, air bubble, air bubble. We had excess load on the skin, and yet we're getting no uptake. And the reason we're getting no uptake is because they have an air bubble. And so then they allow the experiment to continue to run from hour 6 to hour 24. So 18 hours of the underside of the membrane not being hydrated and not being in contact with the receptor fluid. And then they poke the system with a Q-tip. Well, what happens after that is completely meaningless. You've already damaged the membrane to the point you've dried out the membrane. This could, in fact, be rupture of the membrane by poking with the Q-tip, and these results are completely useless. These results never should have been published, but Moody was well connected with the journal where the stuff was published, and so it was published despite reviewers mentioned that this looks a hell of a lot like an air bubble to us. This is the foundation of the wash-in effect. Bad experiments misinterpreted. Here's some more recent work. So given that history, given that the original foundations of the wash-in effect are bogus, there has been a lot of attempts in the recent review papers to run around and find any evidence anywhere else for anything that looks like it might be a wash-in effect. And this is some in vitro data conducted by Forsberg et al., published in 2020. And we have here, so these are wash at 5 minutes, wash at 15 minutes, wash at 45 minutes, and wash at 2 hours. And in all cases, the rate of penetration, the cumulative penetration, is reduced by washing. But there is this little anomalous here in the 2 hour wash. There is a little bump here, which might be an experimental artifact, or it might be real. And the people that are pushing the hypothesis, this work is actually cited as evidence of the wash-in effect on the basis of this non-significant bump in only the two-hour washing. Now, Forsberg et al. Did 5 compounds. There's one other where there's a slight little bump, which is even less impressive than this bump, and 3 compounds for which there was no effect whatsoever. And this is what people, you know, if you look at this figure and see all of this beneficial effect of washing for 5 minutes, 15 minutes, and 45-minute washing, and this still non-significant effect at 2 hours, if your conclusion from looking at this figure is that washing is really scary and you shouldn't wash your skin, then you are a full-fledged member of the wash-in cult. Now, if wash-in were real, the place where it would show in, if it is producing very small and subtle effects, then the place that would be most important is acute toxicants, where even very small exposures have negative effects. But, you know, we have some in vivo animal tests with nerve agents, which are the nastiest things that you can run into. And what do they show? Here's some guinea pig work. And what this figure in the next one, this is VX live in guinea pigs. This is the control. This is the do nothing. This is the soap wash, which in the case of VX is 16 times more protective. This is a specially formulated. One of the things that the chemical warfare people are doing is trying to find cleaning agents which are more efficacious than just soap and water. But soap and water is still the standard for mass casualty kind of events because it's what we have. This is an experimental product which turned out to be not very effective, but just bleach or soap and water were 16 times more effective than doing nothing. And so the notion that soap washing is more dangerous than leaving the stuff on the skin is certainly contradicted by these experiments. And here's Soman experiments and same sort of thing. The degree of efficaciousness of these other wash products is not as great in this case, but still everything is better. Washing of all types is better than doing nothing. Okay, there is, I should mention though, there is such a thing as a spreading around effect. And the efficiency of dermal absorption varies with load. If you put a high load on a small area, you would expect lower uptake than lower loads spread out over a larger area. And if you have a splatter kind of exposure, so if you don't have uniform skin exposure, if you have a splash kind of exposure, and a few pellets sitting on the skin, then when you're deconning that, you have to be careful that you don't spread it around, because in spreading it around, you can actually increase the skin involvement, and then you can get higher uptake. And the spreading around effect was well demonstrated in experiments that were conducted by Mysik et al. These were, again, in vitro experiments. And they put a pellet of a pesticide, paraoxone, on skin. So the skin on the diffusion cell was not anywhere close to being covered by the agent. And then they conducted a shower, which was they pumped some water onto the top of the skin. With detergent in it, which had effect of spreading the pellet around and increasing the surface area. Okay, and that would be okay if they then rinsed rapidly, but they didn't. They left the shower water sitting on the skin for 24 hours. And they got increased uptake, and then they said, see, that proves the wash-in effect. But think about what they've actually done. If you did that in a real-world situation, if you had a mass casualty event and you were running an emergency medical department at a hospital, and a bunch of people with potential chemical exposure presented to you, and what you did was soap them up, wrap them in blankets, and then tell them to go sit in the waiting room for 24 hours, I would hope you would at least get sued, if not arrested. That is gross malpractice from a decon standpoint. And so this proves nothing in terms of the wash-in effect. So my concluding slide is the wash-off effect, and there's lots of evidence, including the Forsberg studies, which I showed previously. and the chemical warfare agent work, the wash off effect is much more important than the wash in effect. It's well documented. It's efficacious. We do know that sooner is better than later. We do know that rinsing is important. Don't leave the stuff on the skin after you soap up, but that's just common sense. So my recommendation to firefighters is use soap and water, use baby wipes, use whatever you have at hand, and get the stuff off your skin. PAHs are skin carcinogens at the point of entry, and skin load is potential dose. Take it off, reduce your risk. Thank you.
We're going to, in the interest of time, we're going to go ahead and do one question from the audience. And then I'll talk a little bit about sort of like next steps. So let me just say thank you very much, Dr. Kissel. And we have you transmitting live here in the room. So I'm going to go ahead and entertain if there's one burning question that we want to ask him from there. Okay. Comment or question?
Question.
Okay. So I'm coming. I'm going to need you to use the mic so other folks in the room can hear. Yep. Thank you.
Do we find any differences between a cold water wash or a warm water wash? Was water temperature as far as opening or closing pores of any significance?
The experimental results that are available are kind of mixed on that. Generally, the solvency of warm soapy water is better than cold water. So I would expect better removals, but given experimental error and other sorts of things, that isn't necessarily demonstrated in the available literature.
All right, thank you so much, Dr. Kissel. I really appreciate your time. I know it's early over on the West Coast, so join me in a round of applause for thanking him for coming through.